to DreamHack 2015. I'm your host, Nimshan. I'm here with Raven and Purple joining us for the next match. We have Ersi and we have Orange already advancing to tomorrow to the top 8. And right now, we're going to see Born to Win versus Torque. And the second match that I have planned for you guys is Secrets versus AK Wonder. How are you guys doing, by the way? Purple, welcome to the desk.
Thanks, man.
How's it going, man?
Good. I just have like 6 hours to kill between my tournament matches, so... yeah, just talk about some Hearthstone, keep myself busy, game, instead of worrying about my next match.
Yeah, that makes sense. Like, how was the tournament for you overall? How did you enjoy the experience?
It's always a clown fiesta here at DreamHack with the 200-man Swiss. Kind of got lucky to get through, I guess. Did really well with Malak, and I played Druid once, I think.
Wow.
So did you expect Malak to perform as well as it has done?
Oh, yeah.
Did you know that it was going to stomp?
Yeah, I put up 80% win rate on ladder over a week. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's pretty reasonable, right?
Good deck to take.
Yeah.
Made a lot of sense. And Raven, how are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, it's good to get in the top 16 matches now. So the last one I cast was the tiebreak match. So yeah, really good to see now that the players now the final stretch of the tournament. And it's actually a big deal for them to advance from top 16 to top 8. Because then there's BlizzCon points on the line, right?
And the money as well. So it's like, if you win this, you actually advance to top 8, you're in the money, you're in the BlizzCon points, and if you lose, you get nothing.
Yeah, it's pretty not great.
And pretty sad.
Oh, it looks like we got a match.
Yeah, the guys already started. So, Torque from France and Born to Win from Czech Republic. Do you know anything about those guys?
Well, I'm part of the French community now, but I know the guy from France is part of the French community.
That's a pretty good guess.
I apologize. I don't actually know much about either guys, but
that's fine.
Torque playing Hunter and with a fairly reasonable start, floated a mana on turn 3 using a quick shot over companion to kill Darnassus, which is completely reasonable.
Yeah, it's absolutely reasonable. But then to follow up on Torque, I actually know Torque from the long time. He is on Team Millennium. They had Maverick. Maverick was one of the greatest players. He retired, though, unfortunately. So maybe Torque is stepping into his shoes. Torque is mostly a streamer and a caster. He's casting a lot in French. And he came here to have fun, like to promote his content on YouTube. He's mostly doing content in French himself. But he is also a great player. He competed in Millennium House Cup 2 times before he qualified for it, I believe. So this is his big chance to shine on the global stage.
Yeah, it must be kind of nice to like turn up to a tournament to just enjoy the experience and then suddenly, oh yeah, top 16.
Yeah.
Okay. maybe I'll like really focus now.
Exactly. And he has a really huge following in France overall. So a lot of French players are actually rooting for him. And it only proves the point that top 16, those are not random guys. He is a great player from France.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, we have Born to Win from Czech Republic. He's Stanislav Sivka's latest partner.
Oh, okay.
Is he?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I've seen Born to Win a lot of online tournaments, but I didn't actually know he practiced with Stan.
I'm going to have to go if he's good, if he's practiced with Stan.
Yeah.
They're actually living together in the
Okay, he's
house.
Really good then. He's really good.
And also, he has double swipe against Hunter, which is pretty nice.
So I'm going to guess like there's a rule against calling games early, but High Main and Hunter's Mark going into a Druid of the Claw. This is absolutely filthy for Hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah, Druid's going to have to coin boom and pray.
It's a good situation for Torque already. Portwin also was playing other card games before, and he was a national champion for Magic.
That's impressive, too.
For Czech Republic. And Czech Republic has a lot of great Magic players.
So is Coin Boom the only way here?
Oh, yeah. Coin Boom's the only line of play.
Yeah, because anything else just doesn't do enough on the board state, right?
You can ghetto clear and take a bunch of damage and maybe recover with a lore heal, assuming that your opponent has nothing in hand.
Yeah.
But
nothing,
if your opponent has minion, that plan doesn't work. So you have to go with the Coin Boom here. And just go on the prayer plan.
Well, even more damage there.
Is there any reason not to just go face?
Absolutely not. You just ignore boom.
Yeah, because you're 27 health, right? There's like what are you actually afraid of?
I actually wouldn't have killed the boom bots either, but I'm guessing he's going to go juggler companion here. And with that play, you kind of don't want to juggle a Boomba and end up with your juggler dead, because that's actually your one of the highest sources of damage. Oh, yeah, absolutely you go face here.
Yeah.
Because if you trade, you just end up in a situation where Force Nature does way too much against your board.
Well, that's 15 points of damage right here, right now. and then you have a quick shot and hero power.
Yeah, minutes. And the thing is with the quick shot as well, he's at the mana where there's pretty much nothing he couldn't like draw, play quick and play quick shot for the next draw, and probably be able to play that as well. Because one high main's already out. Unless he plays boom, maybe that might be the draw. So
given the Huffer actually do like this, where you can actually just deal with the boom and dome with high main in order to boom boat.
Yeah, there's still loads of damage.
Wow, he's actually no mercy. He's just gonna kill everything.
Well, he has ahead so much, and for Druid, it's really hard to deal with the high main.
And Harry Bay comes in to the Druid hand right after Eagle Hornbow gets used.
Pretty sad for Born to Win.
This is rough. He might actually have to lore heal and then go with like a double swipe plan the turn after. Yeah. At this point, all he has to do is weather the storm, because Hunter's out of cards, and just he just has to hope that there's not a Dr. Boom that comes into the Hunter hand or a second high main.
Yeah. Even with the second high main though, if like he cleared well, you know, it stabilized in the next two turns, the second high main gets dropped down. Like he does have a lot of double force as well, so there is a chance that he can actually just push through if he drew the Savage Roar.
That's actually a big guy, so that's kind of a problem.
That's really good draw for Troll. And now he can.
So Hunter's been trading like a whole bunch. I'm wondering if he's trading here too.
Yeah.
I think with this board, if you're gonna start trading, you may as well stick to it and keep the board empty.
I do like the emphasis on when you actually start on a game plan, whether it be a face plan or a board control plan, that you stick through it just for consistency with the game.
And it works for him because right now he's the one with the board. It's really hard to deal with it.
Because going like half either way, you're doing nothing good. That's the problem, isn't it? You've got to actually just whatever you do, you should just commit unless it's actually just about to lose you the game.
And at some point, if he would not clear the boom and the boom buzz, there was a chance for innervate combo that would just kill him.
Yeah.
You don't want to take
that's true.
That's not necessarily something you actually play around, especially with given the context of this game. You actually saw your opponent have a Druid of the Claw on 5, and it wasn't innervated out. So you knew the four cards to, like, the now what it is Wrath, Swipe, Force Nature. He can actually determine that's actually not innervate.
Yeah.
Or else the Druid of the Claw would have
killed. Yeah, because there's no reason, especially against like Hunter, there's no reason not to like hold on to your innervate there.
Oh boy, does he play two types of traps? That would be pretty troll.
It is possible.
So I'm guessing it's free. It might be Freezing Snake. It might be Freezing Bear. Freezing Explosive. It's always Freezing, though. Big guy number three.
And that might actually just be game.
That is
almost certainly game.
That is a nail in the coffin, especially with Freezing Trap on board. So there's going to be 13 on board. He can lore heal to 9. That's not nearly good enough.
And I think, like, this game was exactly how mid-Hunter should play out.
Something really important here is that he actually kills the Mad Scientist with his hero power. Just check Snake Trap and actually see if there's two types of traps in the deck. For next game, it's Last Hero Standing.
Exactly,
you actually just need this information right now. So, he didn't check for Snake. I don't like this. And there's nothing you're drawing into.
Well, he can still check for Snake after.
So you know now going forward into the next game that there's only two freezing, and that information is actually very vital in making your decisions for the next game.
Absolutely. But then on the other hand, that win was really important for Troll. Paladin and Warlock are left for Born to Win. I would say that this is probably Handlock or Malilock, because Stanislav Sivka really loves to control Warlock.
Yep.
And if Born to Win is playing with him, he might go with the same plan more or less.
So Stan brought a Handlock to Seat Story, and then in the last weeks he streamed a bit of Reno Lock, which he got to the top of the legend with. So it could be either one of those decks.
Yeah.
It's almost not certainly Zoo.
Yeah, I was going to say, imagine it's actually not Zoo.
If it's mid-range Paladin, that's an excellent matchup into the mid-range Hunter. So if it is just a mid-range Paladin with like two heals, I'd instant queue that. The Reno Lock is like, If it is Reno Lock, it's sometimes good if you draw the right card at the right time. That's what happens when you have 31 of in the deck.
Yeah, that's the risky play.
Yeah.
Do you like Reno Lock overall?
Absolutely not.
Okay, do you prefer consistency?
I like decks with game plans of actually trying to kill your opponent, getting them from 30
as
to
opposed
zero.
To not dying yourself.
Yes. Yeah. I don't like the healing flats. But that being said, like with the Paladin, if it's Secret Paladin, isn't actually that good. So it looks like it's Reno Lock.
Yeah, just the Soulfire.
Yeah, just the Soulfire is a tell. It is the Reno Lock.
All right. So what is Reno Lock exactly running? Is there like one card or everything?
There can be 31 of us. Notably, there was a Fugit and Stelag in Stensiska's list. So that's really cool if you get the 11-11 on the board.
There's also lists that run just double Molten, right?
Yeah.
There's some lists going around with just two Molten.
Yeah, because Molten is just a very good anti-aggro card. Yeah. So, double Scientist with one Freezing is actually not very good at all. Given one Scientist will guarantee that you not get value.
And there is Farseer for Born to Win.
So there's cards like there as well. There's cards like M-Gang Boss, Urban Ring Farseer, Spellbreaker. There's just
all of the cards.
Yeah, there's just all of the cards.
It's an absolute toolbox deck, right?
Yeah.
Or is there any double?
No, only potentially Molten's.
Sometimes there's double Dark Bomb as well.
Oh, okay.
When you see the Soulfire, it tends to say you don't have the second Dark Bomb because it's kind of the same card in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, the equals actually.
It's why it kind of works, I think, the best in Warlock, because Warlock has a lot of similar cards. Like, they have, like, three AoEs with Demon Wrath as well as Demon Wrath, Shadow Flame, Hellfire. They have, like, as you said, like, Dark Bomb and Soulfire
Demon
that do similar
and
jobs.
Hellfire tend to be almost the same card.
Yeah.
Shadow Flame and Hellfire can.
They
don't have the same mana cost realistically because like you need like an Ancient Watcher to go with Shadow Flame. So Shadow Flame's like 6 mana play. Well, Hellfire's a 4 mana play.
Yeah.
But similar purpose cards, multi-purpose cards. It's very awkward here for him. He has like this random Spellbreaker, and if you go with the Spellbreaker, is it going on the Leoc or the Juggler?
So if you silence the Juggler, basically. You limit the knives.
Yeah, which is probably more than the one extra damage the Leoc is pushing right now.
But now, is there a point to just kill the 4-3 and just master straight onto the Leoc?
I would absolutely hit him in the face. Like, the freezing trap doesn't actually... like.
Oh, of course he's freezing down, isn't he, right?
Do you really care if your opponent has a 6-mana Spellbreaker in here?
Yeah.
I don't think this is...
Well, freezing can actually... Freezing could actually work for their future minions.
Right.
Anything else being played.
But at some point, you expect these Moltens, and like, what else do you want a Freezing Trap? Like, you can't Freezing Trap this.
If there's a
Healbot, for
maybe.
Example.
It seems like Torok has a really consistent strategy with this Hunter. Like, he was trading all the minions, and it actually worked for him.
Yeah, in the last game, and you can see it this game too, where he's consistently going for board control. So, where's this Houndmaster landing on? I guess it. Oh, this is so awkward. He doesn't have a clean way of doing.
Well,
he
needs the juggle, right?
No, the juggler is silenced.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
Yeah, there's just no clean way of doing.
Yeah, this is just not fun.
So I think he's just gonna have to accept that he's gonna be walking into AoE here. There's just no way around it.
Well, can you just like buff and pass, or do you have to clear the?
You
Belcher
still walk into AoE because the Belcher can make the attack into the taunt, and then there's AoE.
Yeah.
So you might as well make the attacks. Instead of giving your opponents the options. I like this the most because you end up with a 5 health Leoc, which will survive like a Watcher Shadow Flame kind of thing.
That Leoc really works for Torok. If that would be a Huffer, that wouldn't be that great, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. I expect Siphon Soul to be the play here. The Leoc is actually representing 7 damage right now.
Yeah.
That's a 7-5, realistically. That can't be VGH'd. It's really
That's
good.
Pretty good,
That's
yeah.
Pretty the times where you actually want Leoc.
Yeah. So yeah, this is pretty straightforward Siphon Soul. And next turn he's probably gonna go on a like big Game Hunter Shadow Flame plan. I don't think he's like in a good enough spot to go with Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah.
If you had Reno Jackson in hand, maybe you go for Dr. Boom because you can just recover after it. But he just has 8 heal, he doesn't have the full like 29.
Unless he actually runs double Dark Bomb, which probably is not the case. But it still seems like Born to Win is a good position because he does have the heals, he does have the Molten Giant as well.
Yep.
Even though it's he's dropping pretty low.
Yeah, I think this has to be a big Game Hunter Shadow Flame turn. You're just dead if you do anything else. 6, 8, 9, 11 showing. I guess you could boom and hope your opponent doesn't have 2 and you top deck Reno.
Do you ever hope your opponent doesn't have 2 playing against Hunter?
No, I do that against Paladin. It works out quite a lot. But
yeah. Against Hunter, maybe not so good. And the thing is here as well, just to note that Torok has left him on 13, which leaves him just out of Molten Healbot range.
Yep,
it's a really good play.
Actually, in general, like you didn't want to skip attacks this turn, but in general, you actually want to be your the cost of the Molten should be actually one less than the mana. So at 7, the optimal number to leave your opponent at is 6 to cut the amount of options Handlock actually has.
Yeah. It's just like, obviously, certain points you have to push to a certain extent.
Certain points you just don't have options, especially when you don't have Kill Command or Quickshot in hand. And at any point, if you get AoE'd, you just lose. So you have to push this damage.
Yeah.
Well, Born to Win has to make a decision. Oh, he's actually going for Molten Shadow Flame instead of...
Yeah,
he's expecting Dr. Boom on turn 7.
Yep, that's what he's playing around.
Oh, he did draw Kill Command as well.
Yep.
No Beast, though.
So you definitely attack because you've seen a Molten, right?
Yeah,
absolutely. Not everyone's playing two, and the odds on having two this early are pretty low.
Yeah, absolutely attack. And there's not much of a difference between 13 and 9 at this point.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good card.
Yeah, and he can help.
If he goes to 6, he is dead to a single Kill Command with a Beast Activator. So that's... If you heal bot, you go to 17, but you end up taking this 5, which is not fun.
Yeah, it's like when the heal's really awkward because it's the heal isn't really healing you to a large extent.
Yeah,
it's not really doing anything.
The Hellfire is healing you for 2 this turn, kind of, plus the juggle, so maybe 3. The heal bot's also healing you for 3.
So you Hellfire and Shredder?
I would probably Hellfire and Shredder. Maybe Zombie Chow, Big Game Hunter, just to be able to actually trigger the freeze trap.
It's such a nerve-wracking decision because Hunter will have the hero power and you're at 6.
Yeah.
So only 4 more damage and you're dead.
An issue as well is like if you drop down the multiple minions to deal with freezing trap, then you're more susceptible to unleash the hound as well.
He could actually also play the Shredder first and then Hellfire and go for a heal. And that's actually what he's going for, which is really cute.
Nice.
Let's see what he gets. I want this to get rewarded.
It's a free 2, but he could go the Vitality Totem once as well.
The Web Spinner.
Yeah.
High impact card.
That Hunter. Tolk is like actually winning 2-0.
Absolutely crushing it with Hunter. Good deck.
Yeah, and like you said, so because it's Reno Lock, it can be a great deck, but it's a double-edged sword, really, isn't it? Because the consistency of having two ofs is just gone straight out the window. And in games like where you're under that much pressure, you really need... And like it's the main ones are like the Argus and the Sun Furies, right? Because not having two... not having 4 Taunt Givers and having half that amount against a deck like that, it's really rough.
It's a good point. Like, this game, if you had Reno, it was like 95 plus to win.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the issue as well is the 2 Taunt Giver minions, there's no replacements, where normally there's like other 4 drops and other 3 drops you can use.
Wow. He had Juggler Unleashed and pitched Juggler. That's interesting. It's like he's looking for a 2 drop, but at the same time...
It's risky, though, because the turn 5...
Yeah, the turn 5 is disgusting. So, as expected, Bordelwin is actually playing Secret Paladin, or else he would have queued the mid-range Paladin first, because it is just a very good matchup. Not a breathtaking start from Torque here.
Yeah, especially because the Secret is going to buff the Secret Keeper.
I think that's okay because it's Freezing Trap though, right?
Yeah, but...
Because either way, like, you do buff it, but you also stop it attacking if he wants to try and keep the buff there.
Yeah, exactly. But then he can play a minion and keep the Secret Keeper or even buff it himself as well.
I do agree, though. I think, like, I believe in this matchup that if you start with Juggler Unleash, like, it's such a swing on turn 5.
Yeah, because it goes into their Challenger turn and they're forced to Consecrate if they have their 1 of Consecrate. Yeah. They Challenger, they lose.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Juggler Unleash is just good in this matchup.
So, overall, it's a good matchup for Torque, right? Like, Hunter versus Paladin?
No.
Not really?
No.
I think you need the swing turn.
You need the swing turn for sure. It's winnable for Hunter. But I don't think any class right now actually wants to be playing against Secret Paladin.
Yeah, I agree, actually. I mean, we had that conversation yesterday, right?
Yeah.
Like I believe the best deck at the moment is Secret Paladin, because if it curves, it will beat most things.
But which variation is the best? Because we have still a couple of them.
Everyone's testing it.
Yeah.
Honestly, it's like very hard to tell, because if you're actually testing and you're just changing 1 or 2 cards, it's going to take hundreds of games to actually figure out the differences between the 1 and 2 cards.
What about the 14-0 Paladin that Hoy is playing?
Oh, yeah. It's like a 2-month-old deck. It's still good.
Yeah.
I'm glad he's sending a message
still
to Blizzard.
Yeah. But you're right. Like the problem is, like, you could take any deck, take 1 card out, and put a random card in. You can still win with it. It doesn't matter what that card is.
So it's looking like he's going on this I like this Kill Command. Yeah, this is good. God, if he had Juggler Unleashed into Hyman, why did he pitch the Juggler? Feels bad, man. Oh, he's got Challenger and Sludge. Like, this is, like...
This is going to get rough quickly.
I think Hunter is, like, a card off from being in a really good spot, and...
Is that card it. Juggler?
Yeah, that card would be Juggler.
Flare is interesting. And he didn't draw it before.
Yeah, he's not revealed. But what's funny, he has not revealed a Flyer, which is good.
So, Flare in this matchup is actually a novice engineer that deals one damage to Boulder Fist Ogre. It's been teched into Hunter, and my argument for that is that's not a very good card. Novice Engineer, Elven Archer combo on a Boulder Fist Ogre.
Yeah.
Not the best.
It's not the best, but it feels good when you delete all the secrets.
Yeah, when there's the full Christmas tree, it feels good. It'd be much better if like you'd expect the matchup to go to Fatigue, but it's not really that.
Do you think the reason for it might be to expect a lot of Freeze Mage, maybe?
It
can actually just win you a game versus a Freeze Mage, where you can do it in Paladin, even on a Christmas tree, and still not win, right? It's not like guaranteed, whereas with Freeze Mage, it will win you the game.
Absolutely. Nailing one Mage Secret is actually better than nailing five Paladin
Secrets. Yeah, 100%.
I wonder if he's actually going to Flare this. No, is it going to go on an owl and a scientist here?
Well, he knows it's a secret paladin. At some point, Mystery Challenger is going to come.
I think by the owl, he's seeing if it's repentance. Because if he dropped High Main with repentance,
really
that would
be rough. Like that sequence as well. With the owl first to check for the repentance.
Yeah, because
like,
it's one.
It's just a tiny little thing, which is really nice.
Small victories.
So it's going to be a coin challenger, and he can actually just get rid of Freezing Trap now, which is pretty cool. If he kills one of the minions, he also plays around Hunter's Mark because the Noble Sack will actually protect the challenger.
Yeah.
So it's pretty important he actually... The proper sequence in my mind is killing the scientist. Okay, just... This is fine, too. As long as you keep... As long as you kill one of the minions, that's fine.
Yeah.
That's a good draw.
Well, so Flare is going to calm down. Flare boys.
Ooh, one golden secret.
Pretty impressive.
This is pretty nice, actually.
It's kind of like a small victory here as well. He has a Hunter's Mark, so Born to Win should be distressed. Normally you feel protected with all the secrets.
Yeah, this is one of the cleanest answers I've seen to Challenger.
And Unleash definitely helps.
He
with
used
that, right?
Three cards to counter one.
Yeah.
That's how good Challenger is. So Beltran Redemption is pretty good against Hunter.
When you've just seen owls.
Yeah, owls gone, so. The saving grace is there's going to be a freezing trap coming out of this.
There's a web spinner as well.
Yep. Fills out the curve, reloads.
Anything can come out of web spinner.
Exactly. It's all your dreams coming true all at once.
Well, the thing is, Born to Win is also running out of cards a bit.
The cards he's got are really valuable, though.
They're definitely higher in. They're definitely very high impact. Like 2 4-drops and a Coghammer. Very high impact cards. I think you just actually start with the Coghammer.
Yeah, would you just Coghammer and shred it? Maybe play Secret Keeper to it and not attack with the Belcher, right? And
just play it around Freezing Trap. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's
it's
okay.
It's not actually that good because the Secret Keeper can be eliminated by something like a Quick Shot. The Shredder is going to stick no matter what.
Yeah, that's true. It just feels bad to try and bounce
and
a Shredder.
And honestly, you don't actually have to worry too much about that Freezing Trap because on board, the slime of the Belcher is actually going to proc it.
Yeah.
I like that play, like just playing more minions to be able to trade into minions from your opponent and Secret Keeper being used. Like, if there is a Quick Shot into Secret Keeper, you can't feel bad about that.
So this game's still pretty even. I think it's going to come down to who actually gets the next big guy.
Yeah.
That's a horse.
Oh. That's reasonable.
Big.
Yeah,
it's
that's reasonable.
Big.
Now, can he win the Joust with one High Main already out of the deck and we've not seen Dr. Boom?
Armored Warehouse is gonna charge!
Oh, he good low step, nice.
So he gets to pick up a kill on a slime, which is, I guess, nice. He gets the creeper and hero power.
Well, it's another minion that has to be answered at some point.
Yep.
I think against this deck as well, getting those hero powers in is actually really important when it's this close.
And looks like Born to Win got the big guy first.
Yeah, but can he play it this turn? Do you just slam it, or do you try to have a Coghammer, Divine Shield?
I think what you want to start the turn by doing is actually freezing trapping the Secret Keeper. The slime is pretty valuable. They're both 1/2s, but one actually blocks 6 damage to your dome. So, yeah. Probably freezing trap the Secret Keeper. Kill the 5/2 of the Shredder and Challenger Dude.
And Challenger.
I wonder how many secrets he actually has in his deck. So we've seen 5 so far.
Yeah, even oh that wow. within secret piled in, there's a lot of variation on the volume of secrets.
Yeah, actually, I kind of like the Coghammer. You might even
the Coghammer was really good if it landed the 50-50 on the Shredder.
But what about just? Can you go face here? So like, what if you just kill the 5/2 with the weapon attack, and then you go blessing on the Shredder and go 8 to face?
It's definitely pretty bold. You already saw the owl, and that's the only thing that would really punish it. So I actually really like that. Yeah.
I think the idea is around, like, if he clears the board, the Hunter's on one card, and Hunter notoriously cannot draw cards.
Yep.
So it's just like, I will just get ahead, you then have to top deck, and I have Challenger.
You are always on a clock against Hunter, however. That's actually a really good roll.
Yeah, he can kill the Shredder yep. here. And he still has ways to just kill Commander 5-4.
1-2.
Wow, this nice. Is such a grindy game.
That Leok just buffed those minions to clear the board.
Wow, so much trading going on this game. Yeah.
He will kill him with hero power only.
I'm going to say, like, there's not a lot of secrets left in Paladin's deck, and that's yeah. probably why he didn't play Challenger last turn. Like, if he was going to get another 4, he probably would have yeah. went with Challenger, so I'm going to guess there's just Noble Sack and Avenge left, and nothing else.
If he even play... Well, he should be playing 2 of each, yeah.
Usually it's either 6 or 7 right now, the number of secrets in this Paladin deck.
Let's see.
Yep. And he is getting to secrets.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's going to be Noble Sack.
Noble Sack on the bench.
And both Unleashes gone. Oh,
quick shot's okay.
Yeah. How do you make this? How do you make these trades? You should know it's Noble Sack Avenge, so you might as well just point face just in case it's not Noble Sack, so you don't have to proc the Avenge. So I guess you're going to have to end up quick shotting whatever gets buffed, unless it's the Challenger, right?
Just going to be damage. Can you try going for face? Like, you can deal at least 7 damage this turn.
You already used. Kill command.
Yeah.
Creep is actually okay. Not amazing.
So I guess you can kill a 1/1 with Leo because the 6/6 is going to eat it for free.
But on the other hand, it's 2 damage as well.
On the other hand, it is 2 damage as well, but it protects one of your dudes. So in the long run, that might actually just be 2 damage. Blessing of Kings is a high impact card that just has immediate impact on the board. So
Blessing of Kings, the 6/6. Go.
If it was 2 turn lethal, it was a pretty realistic play. But
he's
it's
seen
not.
The owl, right?
Yeah.
And he's on his mark.
But the issue is your opponent's at 24 and not 20.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whenever there's a play that sets up lethal, it's very good. When it sets up lethal in 3 turns and you die in 3 turns, it's
yeah.
not
it
so good.
It is maybe less good, yeah.
There's definitely like a Kings on the 1/1 kill the Leok play. I definitely like Kingsing because if you're not playing Blessing Kings, you're actually doing nothing this turn.
I think yeah.
you're developing a one.
And like, what are you actually waiting for with Kings? That's the weird part. You've got all the mana in the world and nothing else to play.
And if he's doing this, is he actually just trading into a 1/1?
I think he should actually go for face.
Yeah. If he did that, it's like a small mistake where he just ended up missing 1 damage.
Yeah, exactly.
Probably will not impact the game in any way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, 1 damage is important, or might be important.
Shredder is a high impact card, and okay, Hunter actually has to go face here. 11,
yeah.
12, 13, 14 on board. You're not that. Ooh.
Is he playing Garand Quartermaster anyway?
Talk only trades.
Yeah, there. He definitely has his game plan. So there's 5, 6, 8 on board. You're at 11, so you're dead to 3. The second quick shot would be lethal if you don't kill the 1/1. And kill command is lethal if you don't kill the creeper.
This is not a terrible situation for Tolk, actually, because Born to Win might be forced to trade, and if he trades, then the long game is actually good for Tolk.
Yeah, the Secret Keeper should go into the 1/1, and because then you're limiting Hunter to a 1-outer. However, if you like go full face, then there's kill command, quick shot, and 2 eagle prone bows. So then it's 4 outs instead of 1. So just killing the 1/1. Multiplies your chances of living by 4.
Pretty
so
okay.
That
play.
Attack should happen, and I would be setting up lethal with 11 to the dome.
12 even?
Oh.
Oh. Now that has to die.
Yeah.
Ooh, thanks. The emote was always coming there. Let's be
yeah,
honest. And now it's a 1 health, so it can be dealt with.
And the beast is still alive after all those turns.
He can actually just go ahead and kill that with his weapon. He takes, like, 2 extra damage, but it's fine. Because Juggler is actually a pretty sick top deck now. Nope.
Houndmaster
is pretty good as well.
Yeah, it gives him a bit more time, right?
There's other ways to clear without having to use the 1 health big the big guys.
Yep. So I think it's just Houndmaster phase.
Yeah, he just has to, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
you push 5 this turn, put your opponent to 6. Your opponent has the full clear, which might actually give you 2 turns.
Yeah.
You have no outs really full though. But it might give you an extra turn.
How much damage is going to win missing?
The Paladin can't draw anything, right? Is there a top deck that wins him this game?
If I don't think there is.
Because he has to kill the creeper.
Tyrion wins the game on the...
Well, yeah.
Because then Born to Win, or Torque has
that's
no
true.
Outs.
I mean, there's nothing to draw for lethal, right?
No. Paladin does not do burst. yeah, it's just Town Master phase. So...
Well, but he wants to trade.
He really wants to trade.
He just wants to kill minions.
Sometimes you just have to throw on the afterburner.
You're playing Hunter. Sometimes you have to just go for it.
Well, you just have to realize there is only 11 points of health.
Oh, goodness. I don't like this.
It's not as if that made a trade awkward.
No.
Like, I would understand it more if it made, like, an awkward, like, he has to run the 5-1 into the creeper. But he has mini bot. The trade doesn't even kill the minion there.
Yeah. So... Juggler dude, both 1-1s are dying and 6 to the face.
Ortark is the only hunter that's never going for face.
He's just
never face.
I mean, maybe he has Wild Pyro in his deck. it would fit his style.
Yeah.
Control hunter. Yeah, there's nothing that does 8.
Yeah, it's not as if he's got a full board for Unleash either.
Oh boy.
Oh, that's Juggler.
There's the Juggler. And Leaf on board, nothing to do here.
Yeah, Juggler would not win the game, even if he would go for face.
No, absolutely not.
Situation, so.
Like, the trade last turn didn't actually impact the game whatsoever.
Yeah, that's true.
Just gave them best chance.
And he played really consistently. But Born to Win is not dead. He is Born to Win.
And if there's a deck that is going to reverse sweep, it's probably Secret Paladin at this point.
Yeah, it's a pretty good deck, I heard.
Talking to all the players this weekend, I've heard a lot of stories, a lot of salt about... getting 3-0'd. Let me guess. Secret Paladin.
if you could change Secret Paladin today, what would you just nerf it? Because I know people who want to just delete it, like, out of the game, which I think is a bit strong.
Probably. Well.
Would, like, pull only X amount of secrets,
maybe,
not all?
It's already X, which is 5. It's not 6. If you play Eye for an Eye, you only get 5. You don't get all 6 secrets.
Yeah.
That's not actually the problem. The problem is the snowball effect from Minibut.
Coghammer, Shredder, Belcher.
Yeah, it's
the
curve
drops. Yeah,
and Paladin just right now has the best two drop, the best 3-drop. Shredder, everyone has the best drop on 4.
Yeah.
But now the new 3-4 dude's really good too in Secret Paladin.
Yeah, keep.
Yeah, I've been playing a lot of that actually in Secret Paladin.
It's just the snowball effect, which all starts at Minibut. It's just Minibut's just too strong.
And they have some good 1-drops as well, because now Secret Keeper is not bad, and you still have Zombie Chow, which is really decent.
Yep, absolutely. So it's Aggro Druid. Aggro Druid, from what I've been told, I haven't played much with the deck, is favored against Secret Paladin.
Is it really favored?
Yes.
Okay, it's favored versus Secret, but it's not favored versus Midrange.
Yes.
Because Midrange can actually heal up.
And there's Big Game Hunter, there's Aldor, there's just all these cool cards.
Yeah.
Coin Juggler without a follow-up is not a bad play. You have a lot of 2-drops in the deck, so it's kind of like a belief play. I would like to see... He expects to get... he doesn't need the mana from Darnassus.
Yeah.
So he wants that trade to happen.
Yeah, because
and
then he can innervate the...
Yeah, he just doesn't need it. Reporting for
duty. It's fine, though, because normally...
And that was the best juggle as well, for talk.
Yeah,
it was good for
talk. This is... Ooh.
Yeah, I was just like, suddenly, do you actually prefer the minions? Because Muster might happen next turn, and then you can just deal with it.
If you use Juggler in this, then you don't have any really... minions to juggle with the turn after into the buster.
Yeah.
Well, you do have the swipe, so you can just swipe phase and just use your minions to go.
Yeah, true, because like Muster might be the response to this play, and then you can just swipe into Druid.
And then, yeah, exactly.
Or because he's a Druid, he'll probably swipe and then draw dot to boom.
And then
just go straight into that.
That is a
Druid thing.
So he actually chooses Muster over Coghammer. He had the option of killing the juggler, but with like Shredder and Belcher in hand, the Coghammer actually gets a lot of value. So I like the keeper. You get to kill 2 dudes and develop a 2/4, assuming the keeper
actually. Yeah, leave more power on the board now.
Yeah,
it's okay. It's gonna draw Dr. Boom. It'll be fine.
Well, keeper is good versus Tyrion overall, right? And that Tyrion just comes.
You're planning on ending game before that as Aggro Druid.
Well, but Belchers as well. So
yeah.
There are targets.
Absolutely. Ooh, that is an interesting card. So Shade of Naxxramas is really, really slow in this deck. The new Raptor card, the 3/2 dude in Druid, has not really impressed me. You get a lot of 1-1s as 1-drops. It's not the best. So Horse Rider is something that impacts the board and actually can go phase for 2 as well.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool.
And also the Horse Rider is something you can weave in with, because a lot of the time with this deck, you're not waiting for turn 9 Savage Roar combo.
Absolutely
you just
not.
Savage Roar when you have minions on the board.
Absolutely.
And being able to like 6 mana with this, Savage Roar with some more minions, that's a lot of burst. And the ability for it to actually trade up, if like through a taunt maybe with Savage Roar, and then still be on the board is actually really nice.
I like that.
I like this Blessing of Kings for sure.
If you play Belcher, then like Keeper plus Horse Rider.
I like removing the Druid of Claw. This turn, you could have done it with the Kings, or you could have also done it with the Coghammer. Both were fun.
So much burst.
Yeah. I think he has to check for the Noble Sacrifice, right?
That's interesting. Does that mean he's going with the Silence instead of the 2-drop and the 3-drop?
He has 6 mana, right? So
yeah, because you'd attack with a Horse Rider in first, right? To check for the Noble Sacrifice, I guess?
He could have done that, yeah. So yeah, no respect for the 8-3.
Well, he's on 30 health, to be fair.
You're a druid, you don't have to respect this. Like, you still need the silence for a possible taunt, and that's it. You just
well, the thing
face.
Is, well, do you respect an 8-3 when your opponent's on 8 and
you're
on 30?
Oh, goodness.
Maybe he should have now.
That's a good pop off the shredder right there.
It's quite funny.
But silence is actually going to negate some of the Armorsmith. You don't get the bonus from like having to plow through the
through
the
belcher. Still, like, you do gain life after because you can use your minions to trade.
There's also a second. He's not silencing the Armorsmith. He's silencing Sludge.
Yeah, obviously.
And innovate low step go.
Yeah, the low step's coming down for sure here. But the second belcher is going to keep him in this, which is really cool. He's going to have an option of killing the Keeper of the Grove or the 2-1 with his 2 minions.
Yeah, that Armorsmith is actually changing this game a lot.
Ooh, and Minibot's a solid drop. That Armorsmith is actually going to carry this game. There's a second Belcher, and then it's going to go right into Tyrion. So, yeah.
And you gain life, and you've seen one swipe, so there's not that much burst, and Armorsmith just gaining even the 3 points of health is already very
And the Druid's not got card draw. So he's literally top decking
you
tiny minions.
You have Cycle though.
If
you have Fel Reaver.
What if he gets Savage Roar?
Yeah, you can thin your deck with Fel Reaver. That's the game plan going forward. Yeah.
Is Savage Roar just winning this game?
Not through the Sludge now.
Yeah, I don't even want to sit and do the armor maths.
There's only with the 2-1 charge.
Yeah, you have 2-1 charge would be a 4-1 charge.
Yeah, but then you have 2-4s. The low feb, the 7 of the low feb still ends up going into the front half, and. It's not Savage Roar.
Yeah, and it's not.
Yeah, so, oh boy. I think you have to actually put your guy in charge, and you need to get this Armorsmith off the board somehow. Yeah.
It's going to get, because you know as well. Like,
unless it's getting buffed, no.
Oh boy. That's actually, he actually dodged a bullet on that one. If you could have removed the Armorsmith, you were done for this game.
4-4 Armorsmith would be hilarious.
And 4 armor gain.
But then still, there's Tyrion coming.
Yep.
The justice delight.
Druid is out of stuff. Yeah, he's going to charge and kill the armor soon. Very solid play. And knock off the bubble off the minibot, I guess?
Well, Pulofeb is going to die to that, but what can he do?
Well, at least the minibot goes with
just
it.
Just going to poke someone.
Face, that's interesting.
Yeah, damage matters.
I suppose the idea is with like how powerful Savage Roar can be, like one extra point of damage might actually make a big difference.
Absolutely.
All right, so what do you do now? Because if that's the Doomsayer, that's getting awkward. If that's Mana Wraith, it's awkward. If that's Weblord, it probably doesn't matter.
You just slam Tyrion, right?
I like this. Ignore Shredder.
You've seen one Keeper, like, just slam Tyrion, it's so safe, and this is actually ending the game quicker for the Paladin.
Oh boy. Yeah, it definitely is.
Face tank Tyrion?
Unfortunately, I said at the start that this is actually a favored matchup for Druid. And what Paladin did this game, drew double Sludge, Tyrion, Coghammer,
and Armorsmith.
All the defense, and...
If that would not be an Armorsmith, you can deal 2 damage to face with the Living Root and then hope for swipe to finish the game.
So,
absolutely.
One guy got an Armorsmith, one guy got a Novice Engineer from Shredder. So,
Shredder drops actually do impact high level Hearthstone quite a bit. I just taunt up again, and there's no reason to play Boom. You can just go face for 12, 14, 16 this turn.
Yep. That's Noble Sacrifice as well, right?
Yeah. Actually, you can actually use the mini-bot to kill a dude.
I like that.
Why does he make the dude before the Coghammer? Does he actually want to taunt the one?
Does it really... he actually got the one.
Well, that's what he's doing.
But does it really matter, though? Like,
not really,
kill
no.
2 dudes. Then Tyrion is not really contested.
He can definitely afford to give up that 1 damage. I think or that 2 damage. He can probably give up the 2 damage from the Cog Hammer and kill a guy so the Tyrion doesn't die on board.
Absolutely, yeah. And then go 12 to face.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it seems like this match will be in the bag of Born to Win, and then we are going to have a decider Paladin and Paladin action.
Oh, man.
That's something we haven't seen in a while. Don't really.
No, those Paladin matches,
Savage
we don't cast
Roar
a lot of those.
Is 2 off.
Oh, so the Armorsmith.
Yeah.
The Armorsmith.
Actually, no, there's a 1-1 taunt. Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
1-1 taunt was good.
Yeah.
At the end. Oh, man. So close.
That was a crazy game.
And that was kind of reset.
If Paladin always wins, like, what happens when 2 Paladins play?
Well, right now, Born to Win has a mental advantage.
I think you just hope they both lose somehow.
Yeah, that's the real that's the real victory here.
That's my feeling on the current metagame.
Losers. Come on. Like, honestly, guys, mental advantage. Purple, tell me, how good is it? Because Born to Win is coming into this last game with a 2-0 lead. And Torok was leading, and now he lost 2 games in a row.
Yeah, you kind of get down on yourself. Like, after 4 games, the first 2 you kind of forgot about.
Yeah.
It's just recent history in your mind, and you're just like, I lost 2 straight games.
Yeah.
So
when I was winning so hard.
Momentum is definitely on Born to Win's side. And Torok is definitely feeling kind of crappy right now.
Turn 1 Repentance. Would you have played that?
No.
Like, the only thing is to, like, bait out. But you don't bait anything because the Paladin's always going to attack.
The
right?
One thing it does do is keep a Secret Keeper at 2 health with 1 secret, which will change trade into the mini-bot.
Yeah.
So it does do that. But against other things, it does not do
well,
so much.
Well, in theory, you will be able to heal the mini-bot with Master of Battle.
And keep the 2-2 alive, which is okay, yeah. So this is a good Noble Sack Avenge turn instead of playing your Juggler and letting it die to the mini-bot. that's like, there's like 4 or sometimes 5 different types of secrets in these deck, and Noble Sack Avenge is the one combination that goes very, very well together.
You're okay. So if you're going to draw secrets early on, and then have mini-bot as well, like that's the one you want.
Like
right?
if you draw Secret Keeper, Noble Sack Avenge, you're probably going to win that game.
Yeah. You're probably not going to care about when it gets to turn 6 and you've not drawn more secrets.
Yeah, you get like a 6-6 on the board, like turn 3.
Then Secret
you're
Keeper
doing good.
Undertaker
turns into Undertaker, yeah. I've seen that. I've seen Secret Keepers being really huge and unstoppable.
It's also really important to actually save your Jugglers in this matchup. For actually, usually you only have 1 Consecrate in these decks, so it's like AoE.
Yeah.
It's like getting no value if you're Flame Waker and Tempo Mage. Same kind of concept.
And especially, like as you said, in the mirror, it sort of works like we were talking about Juggler and Leash worked when
you
Hunter. Like, you need to... You're playing 1-1s, but guess what? So is your opponent. So if you've got the way to clear them easily with Juggles, then that's what you need to do.
Yeah, Juggler Unleash the Dudes is the same as Juggler Unleash the Hounds.
Yeah, Unleash
the Dudes.
Pretty
much the same thing. This isn't actually that bad for Torok here. There's a 5-3, but the 5-3 doesn't really do much.
Well, the good thing for Torok is that he will be the first to play Mistress Changer.
Yeah, because
and he'll also be the
when used the coin,
he'll also
right?
be the third to play Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah, that's true.
There's gonna be a lot of challenging this game.
Nobody wants to know each other.
And also, there's no turn 4 for Born to Win.
No, and there's not actually a turn 3. The turn 4 is probably going to have to be Juggler Dude, I think.
Yeah.
Instead of playing the Juggler now and just letting it die. That being said, if you draw something like Shredder or Muster for Battle next turn, anything that costs more than 2, it's a mistake not play the Juggler now.
Can you go for face here? Because if he killed the 2-2, it doesn't do anything. So
I would go face, and oh, he plays the Juggler. So he's...
Do you just want to soak up the minions on the board? Is that the plan, just to reduce back down?
Well, yeah, I think it's fine because there is 5 health, and there was, 5 as well. So basically, everything would have to go into the
board. Yeah, exactly. It's just wanted to soak up the board.
Ooh. So this is always a decision, whether you trade in the mini bot or 2 of the 1-1s. I like keeping the 1-1s there, given you just saw the Juggler.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there's not much of a difference either way.
Better versus Slime if you have a 2-2 minion instead of 2-1 1-1s.
Yes, it's better against Sludge on 5, but that's thinking way ahead.
This is going to be pretty nice, though. This is a pretty good setup.
Yeah, so Born to Win has an insane curve. He's just missing the boom, and he's got the best possible curve.
And with the weapon's actually huge here, because it makes Belcher a lot less significant.
Absolutely.
And getting the 1-1 out, he can just throw that away, easily clear up the ooze, and then just carry on. And then suddenly, like, the other challenge is just too late.
I like this a lot, the mustard for battle over the Belcher. Playing Belcher into a tree silver and a dude.
Yeah, that, exactly, yeah. It's just,
and
it's not good.
And a mini bot as well, right? Just killing the 1-2.
Yeah.
Not do anything.
Oh, wow. Okay, so he doesn't want to deal with a bench. I actually like this attack a lot. Also, going into the challenger turn, proccing secrets doesn't really make sense, because then
yeah,
a new
it draws
secret
more
comes
out
back.
Of the deck, yeah.
So yeah, so kind of Born to Win is shafted in a bench from all the right, challenger. So
Torque is back to the trading game.
Yeah. Yeah, the trading
even
game.
With Avenge there, he decides to trade, which is definitely interesting. I guess with the true silver, he can just
yeah, I was going to say, because he can clear everything. This I do like this, because now this is the problem. Like, this is what you want to set up a secret paladin. Yep. You've got your challenger. You actually managed to get additional minions as well, and they've
does
got nothing.
Does Torok play Repentance? That's yes,
he must
do,
right? Yeah.
Oh, no.
That was Covenant of Spirit. Yeah.
Yeah, Repentance was game over there.
Well, he did play Repentance at the very beginning.
Yes, he did. Okay, he doesn't have two.
Well, there's Tyrion now.
That is. Well,
So Torque will be the first to play Tyrion. He is the first to play everything.
Yeah, absolutely. The person on coin ends up at a disadvantage in these kind of games, because everything you do is just a turn later. So your opponent just has everything out first. Therefore, you're always behind.
Yeah.
Even the thing is, it's not like you can say, "Oh well, I'll wait and coin challenger out." A lot of time, you have to coin early to, or you're dead anyway. You know, you lose so much tempo. The coin's used by like turn one or two normally.
Because you know you're playing versus Secret Paladin, can you just continue trading?
And no,
play your
smock.
Mysterious Challenger as well.
That'd be.
You have 10 damage to push, and Mysterious. Yeah, and the second Mysterious Challenger into Tyrion with Silence.
I don't think you have any reason not to trade in this spot. If you're, I guess, Consecrate. Maybe Face is the place here.
I would have gone Face,
well,
but I'm quite aggressive.
He didn't
so,
play
so.
Challenger.
Well,
is it because he's already got secrets?
Yeah,
but that shouldn't matter at this point. He's played another 6-6. Like, there's a 7-7 and a 6-6 on the board.
There was
secrets.
A Repentance.
There was a Repentance. So it's pretty smart, actually. Yeah.
So he's letting the competitive go off on one minion, which is pretty good play. Yeah, thinking of the Repentance, that was actually probably his best line.
Yeah, I didn't realize Repentance was
you definitely feel a little stupid playing an owl into no silence when it's over your 6-6.
Yeah, but on the other hand, you feel probably even more stupid if you play Mysterious Challenger, which doesn't give you secrets because
and
your
then
secrets
and
are
it gets
there.
And
it
gets
goes
one out.
And then you get consecrated out of the game, for sure.
So, yeah, Torque is playing really well here. Born to Win as well, but Torque has an
that
advantage.
Is one big Iron Beak Owl. That is one scary owl. So 7-7 has straight into 7-7. And gotta go if feels bad man on this one. Oh. I guess this is fine as well. Making that trade makes a lot of sense too, because the 5-3 could go into the sludge, and the 7-7 can go into sludge anyways.
Yeah.
Oh, oh man.
So a bit out of sync with the drawing, but still got it. Still pretty good, right?
Yeah. Alright, so no hoot on Born to Win side. Definitely not looking good for him. He can even knock off the bubble to play around Blessing again.
Makes
He's
sense.
So far ahead. Yeah, you just play Tyrion and you knock off the shield with the mini bot. You can't afford to take the 6 here. And you definitely have to knock off the shield or it just eats your Tyrion for free.
They both have almost the same life total. But then
one has Dr. Boom.
Yep. Dr. Boom is pretty cool here, but this Tyrion with the bubble, there's nothing to knock off the bubble.
Well, you do trade both minions, and then you have the swing with the Ashbringer.
Yeah, you get the first swing, and you're already 3 points ahead, which is a huge deal, and you have Dr. Boom, which
is and you've got Dr. Boom.
As gross as this is, it's
and
fine.
You can also just play Mystery Challenger. If there's some second Noble Sacrifice,
yeah, you
can
just get your Noble. You're not worried that your opponent has 12 in hand though, playing against Paladin. There's actually no burst in there, which is one of the reasons it's actually not completely busted. They can't do anything from hand.
Yeah.
So if you can manage the board, you're okay against it.
But this is the impact going first has is really crazy.
Absolutely.
If you both draw evenly, going first just wins.
If you're if you're playing any mirror match, you are favored going first without the coin, based on you go first. So there, and you're doing the same thing. You have the same
so you're always
plan,
ahead.
You have the same cards. So just not having coin is a huge advantage in situations.
Yeah, and basically you win before your opponent. And this is where the stories come, where I had everything, but he killed me before I was able to kill him.
You know, Torlk takes it 3-2.
Yeah.
Really close up. Secret Paladin almost making a reverse sweep. Yeah. Unfortunately, Secret Paladin couldn't make the reverse sweep because Secret Paladin came in the way.
Yeah. The only thing that can stop Secret Paladin is Secret Paladin.
So Paladin ultimately wins, but Torlk played really well with the Hunter as well. And, well, what an amazing match. So I'm sure French community is super happy right now, having Torlk advancing to the top 8, being in the money. And, you know, he's casting a lot in French, and he's having his own YouTube channel, and now he's the one who's shining. But I don't know if we have a second match still running, if they finished before. Okay, so the second match ended, AK Wonder versus Secrets. Do we know who actually won that match? AK Wonder won. So AK Wonder is the second guy advancing to the top 8. This means we have 4 players already. AK Wonder, we have Torlk, we have Orange, and we also have Ersi.
Yeah.
So those are our 4 players. We have 4 more players to decide. So 8 players still here. Purple. How are you feeling before your match?
Oh, man. Just reminded me I'm nervous.
Oh, yeah. You do have to play a game as well today.
I'll be playing shortly. So
oh, so we have
it'll be a fun time.
We have the bracket open. There's some, like, there's, I mean, specifically when we saw the bracket, I was like, looking forward to your match just to see more of the Umali lock. And also, Hoi and Kranich. That, I can't wait to watch that.
Well, I can't wait to watch Purple versus Dragon Albert.
Yeah, I'm not looking forward to it. I'm actually afraid of dragons.
Have you seen Dragon Albert? Have you met him?
I have not, actually.
Have you done any? Have you got any research on his decks?
Yeah, I know card for card what his three decks are.
Oh, well, that's useful, I guess.
I think Dragon Albert was the first person to actually advance to the top 16. I was just walking around. The round started, and then there's this one cheerful kid just jumping around. He's like, "Yes, yes."
Feels good.
Hey, man, how does it feel? Oh, feels good.
He beat Super JJ, right?
Yeah, he eliminated Super JJ from the tournament. Super JJ had 3 rounds to win just one match. Then you killed him, then he lost one more, and then Dragon Albert just wrecked him with his decks. Yep. Oh, no, wait. That wasn't Dragon Albert.
Oh, no, that was the, was his name? The one who played the crazy decks, right?
Yeah, the Dragon decks.
Aldo.
From Sweden.
That was still a good story, even if it wasn't about the right person.
That's true. You kinda
it still happened. It happened to someone, right?
Well, we had a really good day before and a great day today, so we have a lot of good stories. But the story for this match is ending. And guys, thank you so much for joining me for this one. For you guys in front of the PCs just watching the stream right now, we'll have more Hearthstone action for you, but after the break, so stay tuned.